What's going on, Sunnybrook? Well, welcome to church this morning. I hope you're having an awesome Sunday this morning. I hope you've been in church. I hope you've been in Sunday school, wherever you've been. I hope you've been with God. But thank you for joining us this morning. I wanted you to watch that video because I am pumped up for the worship this week. Last week, I had a lot of trouble, as I told you, coming up with the songs. This week, God was very clear on what he wanted to do this week with our worship. So stand up with me. We're going to do some worship this morning. I hope you're ready for some rock because it's going to be rocking this morning here in the house. So here we go. I want to preface, hang on. I built you up to bring you down. The last few weeks, we've been talking about walking by faith. We've been talking about belief. We've been talking about all kinds of different things. But really what I want to talk to you about this morning and what our worship is about this morning is, are you saved? Do you know for a fact that you are washed by the blood? Do you know that Jesus Christ is going to stand up for you on that altar and say, I know him, God, bring him in? And that's the question that you got to ask this morning. It doesn't matter where you've been in your life. It doesn't matter what you've been through in your life. It doesn't matter what you've done. Salvation is yours if you want it. You just have to ask for it, and you have to believe in Jesus. And so this morning as we go through our worship, I want you to think about that. I want you to think about salvation. I want you to think about what your relationship is with God, and I want you to think about that as we worship and we lift his name this morning in praise. Here we go.
above the horizon, a new light is shining. Salvation is on its way.
Well, welcome to church. If you're not worshiping now, I don't know what's going on with you. Bacon, would you pray for us this morning, brother? So I hope you're thinking about it this morning. Here we go. For so long I carried the weight of my past, crippled by burdens like stones on my back. I thought I had fallen too far from your grace, but you came and showed me the way. When I was lost, soul searching, you were the ground beneath my feet. When I was a blind man begging, you were the eyes so I could see. When the smoke was rising up, you were the air that I could breathe. You gave me hope, you gave me something to believe. Now I'm a the Nord here. Woo. Okay, bear with me a minute. I've lost everything here. Ooh. So this morning, as I was going through everything, and I was thinking about what we were going to do, and the songs that I had planned this week, and the things that had come to my mind this week as I was going through the week, this song came to mind, and it's an old song from Mark Schultz. I don't know if all y'all remember Mark Schultz, but he's an old bald-headed guy. He's not old. He's not that old, but anyways, he's from 2005. So, I mean, if you think about it, that's 15 years ago. So that's a pretty old song, you know. But it's an old song, and it's called I Am. And it's such an awesome song. And I forget about some of these songs. And as I'm going through my week, and I'm listening to worship music, and I'm praying through what I want to do, what I think God wants us to do for worship, this song came to mind. And it just resounded with me this week. And I thought about it, and I thought, how many different names can you think of for God? Like, how many different names are there? There are so many. I mean, we go through some of the things with my daughter, and we say, you know, Emmanuel, Jesus, Light of the World, all kinds of different names. But I thought about it, and I thought, why does he have all these different names? And as I was thinking through it, and I was praying through this week, I thought, it's whatever you need at that time. That's the name he is for you. And so as we sing this song, it's called I Am. Such an awesome song. I love it. But as we sing this song and you think about the different names of God and what he is to you right now, what is the name of God for you right now? Is it Father? Is it Maker of the heavens? Bright and morning star? Breath of all creation? One who walked on water? Calm the seas? Miracles and wonders? I mean, that's just some of the things that I, in this song, and as I was thinking through it, Alpha and Omega, I mean, such awesome names. So what is he this morning for you? Comforter, teacher, father, whatever it is this morning, as we sing this song, think about that, and think about the different names of God and what he is to you, because he really does have those names for a reason. It's just sometimes you have to think about what it is exactly that he's trying to do for you in that instance. So here we go. I am the maker of the heavens. I am the breath of all the morning star. I am one who brought the seas. I am the one who walked on water. Calm the seas, I am the miracles and wonders. So come and see and follow me, and you will know that I am the fountain of living water, the risen Son of Man, the healer of the broken. Beginning and the end, I am. I am the spirit deep inside you. I am the word upon your heart. I am the one who even knew you before your birth. holy God.
We are often told, God loves you. But what does that really mean? That some impersonal force, galaxies away, may consider you from time to time? Or that you are a single drop in a vast ocean of humanity, and God cares for all of it? There are billions of lives, billions of stories. Can we really believe he has great destinies planned for all of them? Surely the ruler of the universe has more important affairs than to notice the needs of one singular individual. But hear this, nothing could be further from the truth. When God says, I love you, it means that he crafted every detail of your being. Your every feature is his perfect design. His mind perceives your worries and your thoughts. His heart is broken by your pain. You are his child, created in his image. Your value exceeds all the riches of earth. Your worth extends beyond the stars. And though you may be unaware, he's carefully constructing the events of your life to build his kingdom. If you are willing, he can and will achieve wonders through your hands. It is the deepest passion, the most meaningful promise. It is your security, your hope, and your future. It is the truth beyond doubt. God loves you.
Good morning.
Can you hear me?
All right, it's on. It's in my pocket, so I wasn't sure. Pardon me. Good morning, everybody. I'd like to thank you guys for coming out tonight. Today, I don't even know what time of day it is anymore. I've been at home for a really long time. That's the one thing I've noticed. Like, my days, I don't even know. I mean, I've been home with a four-year-old, so it's my brain's on Barbie dolls, and I don't know what else. So, yeah. But no, I'd like to thank you guys for another opportunity to come out and preach. Brother Mike called me the other day and asked me, and while I was actually in the middle of studying for a small group lesson on Wednesday, and I'm like, sure, thank God, let's just do this. The world right now is kind of crazy, kind of weird. There's a lot of weird stuff going on. And, I'm going to start before I even do this. We need to pray for everybody right now. People are losing their minds. It's 2020 has been a weird year. Every month I see something online, somebody's like, the next opponent has entered the ring. But we need to pray. Christians now more than ever, we need to pray. Because, God is still in control. God is still on the throne. He is still the maker, the creator, in charge of everything. And, with everything going on, people will somewhat rightfully ask, well, where is he right now? And he's here. He's with us. But it's the same people who ask those things that are not with him. And that's where the problem usually comes in, is because people expect things from God and expect nothing. They don't expect have to, follow him or worship him. They just think God should just fix all these things and then that's it. Well, that's not how it works. We as Christians are supposed to follow God and follow his calling for us. And you know, follow what he wants us to do. And I was I was listening to a bit of a sermon last night online, and the preacher said, we spend so much, you know, kind of, you know, not verbatim, but we spend so much time looking for the will of God and not looking for God. And the will of God is, God, what do you want me to do? And then let me do it. Searching and following God is, God, here I am. It's not a, you know, what do you want me to do? It's like, what do you want to do with me? You know, you just take control. Because if we, and I'm guilty, you know, God, what do you want me to do? I've asked it for years. What do you want me, Jeff Millsaps, to do with my life? And that hit really hard when I was listening, you know, watching that sermon snippet last night, because I'm like, huh, I've never thought of it that way. You know, the fact that I've always been looking, well, God, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? And actually, that leads us in to what God gave me. And if I had to title it, it would be called, What Does God Want From Us? Pardon me. Right now, being an asthmatic is a horrible thing, because everyone thinks you're plagued. But you cough in public, and I'm like, I'm asthmatic, don't hit me, please. Don't chase me away. But we're going to start in Jeremiah 1. And I printed my words out really small for some reason. So we're going to kind of skip ahead to 4, because 1 is setting a timeline, you know, in the words of Jeremiah, and then in the years of this and the sons of this and all that stuff, and the fifth, and until the exile of Jerusalem in the fifth month. There's a lot of words there I'm not sure how to pronounce, names and such. So, but it's in 4, it says, Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, and this is Jeremiah speaking, says, Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, Alas, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak because I am a youth. But the Lord said to me, Do not say I am a youth, because everywhere I send you, you shall go. And all that I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. And the Lord stretched out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have appointed you this day over the nations and over the kingdoms, to pluck up and break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. Now, here's a young man, kind of dear to my heart in some ways, who says, you know, God says, before I even made you, before you were born, this is what you were going to do. This is the path that was set before you. You were called and made specifically in your genetics, in your DNA, in your soul, in your persons. You were made to be a prophet for me. And Jeremiah says, I can't. I'm young. I'm a kid. I can't do this. And I can't think of the actual age, but I know in the Hebrew faith, like to be a minister or to be a priest, you have to be a certain age, you have to be married, etc. And at this point, he was like, I can't do this. I'm way too young. I cannot do this. And the reason this hits home with me is because, you know, I was called to preach at 19 years old. Now, you put a 19-year-old kid who doesn't look much different now, really, except for the beard and older and grayer. But anyway, not much different. But, you know, you put a 19-year-old kid in front of a congregation of, you know, 40 and 50-year-olds, my first thought is the same. They're not going to listen to a thing I say. I don't have the life experience they do. I don't have the, you know, biblical knowledge they do. I don't have, you know, the experiences they do. They're not going to listen to a thing I tell them. they're not going to believe me. They're not going to want to believe me. They're going to ignore me at the first time they see me get up there in a t-shirt and jeans. At the time, it was not quite so okay to wear jeans, you know, preaching. But I'm not a suit and tie guy, so I'm just like, you know, God made me me, so I'm just going to be who I am. And it was a good probably 3 years before I ever stood. I may have stood once. It's been a long time ago. But after that, there were some things happened, and I was like, I'm not ready to do this. I can't do this. And I stepped back, and I walked away. I stayed in church, and that sort of thing, but I didn't do what I was supposed to do. But then I look at the words here, and I wish I would have been able to read this like I am now, then, because God said, don't say you can't do this because you're too young. Don't say that. He said, because when you speak, it is me speaking. The understanding and the supposed knowledge and experiences of the people in the congregation honestly become a moot point when God is speaking. And that's honestly what God was saying here. What I say, you will say. Where I say to go, you will go. And they will listen. And that's the thing. God will only call people to do things that he knows they can and will do. And here, he told Jeremiah, you were going to do this before you were born. This was your job before you were born. You just didn't know it yet. So, pardon me. So the question is, what did God want from Jeremiah? Did God want Jeremiah his knowledge? Did he want his wisdom? He didn't have any. He was a kid. Did he want Jeremiah's, you know, ability to speak perfectly? No, he was a kid. God wanted his boldness, his courage. God wanted Jeremiah knowing that he would say what God told him to say. He knew that Jeremiah would do this. That's the reason he said, what I say, you will say. Where I say to go, you will go. And they will listen. He wasn't asking Jeremiah for, you know, to be perfect. He wasn't asking for Jeremiah to go in and go into the temples, get all up in the robes, do all this stuff, this fancy, you know, traditional things. He wasn't asking for any of that. He just wanted Jeremiah to go and speak and be bold and be courageous. That's all he wanted from Jeremiah. Now we're going to move on to another one. And as I was studying this last night, I was audibly, like I had my headphones on listening to worship music, and I was laughing out loud to where I got some strange looks in my household. Because this one, we always look at this, it's the story of the calling on Moses' life. And we look at this in such a serious aspect because it is. Because, you know, this is when God came to Moses and told him, you know, go to Egypt. This is the time. But not very often do I hear this broken down to the way God kind of broke it down to me. And we're going to skip around a little bit with the verses because there's a lot. So I just kind of condensed some. So leading up to this point, Moses was tending to the flock, tending to, you know, the animals in the fields. And this is where God appeared in a burning bush. And Moses went and spoke to him. God said, take your shoes off. You know, this is holy ground. We know this part of the story. And this is where God laid out the plan for Moses to go and free his people. This is the beginning of this. And we'll start in Exodus 3, verse 10. It says, therefore, come now, and I will send you to Pharaoh, so that you may bring my people, the sons of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, and that I should bring the sons of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, certainly, I will be with you. That is, I who have sent you, when you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship the God at this mountain. And here comes excuse number one. Then Moses said to God, "Behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you.' Now they may say to me, 'What is his name?' What shall I say to them?" And that's why I love the song choice today. It says, God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And he said, "Thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent you." And I love the fact that that song was sung this morning, because that's perfect for this. Because it doesn't say, you know, your king, your ruler, you know, your salvation, your God. It says, "I am who I am has sent me." Now, God continues on giving some more description of what Moses is to tell the people, you know, through, it's like 9 or 10 more verses. God is just laying out, he's like, "Listen, do these exact steps and you'll be fine." And then in Exodus 4, 1 through 5, it says, "Then Moses said," after hearing all this, God, Moses is talking to a bush that's on fire. Has anybody ever done that? I'm like, you're talking to a bush that's on fire and it's God. And you're like, "I don't know. Maybe I shouldn't do it. Well, what if?" So they said, Moses said, "Well, what if they will not believe me or listen to what I say? For they may say, 'The Lord has not appeared to you.' The Lord said to him, 'What is it that in what is that in your hand?' And he said, 'A staff.' Then he said, 'Throw it on the ground.' And he threw it on the ground and it became a serpent, and Moses fled from it. But the Lord said to Moses, 'Stretch out your hand and grasp it by its tail.' So he stretched out his hand and caught it, and it became a staff in his hand. That they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has appeared to you." He said, "Perform this miracle." So he's already told Moses, "Follow these steps and everything will be fine. I'm with you." And Moses is like, "Well, what if they don't believe me?" "Throw your stick on the ground. It'll be a snake. Pick it up. You're fine." Then God goes on to say, and he has Moses take his hand, put it to his bosom, remove it, and it says that his hand became his leprosy, had leprosy like snow. So his hand was falling apart right in front of his face. And God said, "Return your hand to your bosom and remove it again." And he did that, and he was healed. But this wasn't enough. God said, "And if they still don't believe you, go get some water from the river, pour it on the ground, and it'll turn to blood." So in this story of Moses, which this one made me feel so much better about myself in some ways, because in this story, God laid out the entire plan, step by step what to do, step by step how to, you know, tell the people, well, that who sent them? Well, what if they don't believe me? Perform one of these three miracles or all three, and they'll believe you. Okay, so going into Exodus, put 5, but I'm pretty sure it's supposed to be 4, 10 through 13. Moses still is coming up with excuses. Then Moses said to the Lord, "Please, Lord, I've never been eloquent, neither recently nor in time past, nor since you have spoken to your servant." So he's saying, "I'm not good with speaking in the past, right now, or since this conversation started." And he says, "I am slow of speech and slow of tongue." And this is just a Jeff thing, but I really think, and I mean, not just Jeff thing, says God's getting mad, says he's getting angry, but I can feel the annoyance in this scripture. He's like, "The Lord said to him, 'Who has made a man's mouth? Or who makes him mute or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now then go, and I, even I, will be your with your mouth and teach you what you are to say.'" So God's like, "Who made you? Who created you to do this? Who put you together to do this? Go, and I'll do the talking." Just like he said to Jeremiah, "I will do the talking. You just got to go and open your mouth. But then Moses responds, but he said, please, Lord, now send a message by whomever you will. Just send somebody else. Now, I'm going to step on my own shins here. How many times have we said, God, just have somebody else do it? I can't do this. I don't want to do this. I don't have the ability. I don't, you know. And it's funny, you know, Mike and I have known each other for years, and knowing how I communicate normally, I would have never thought God would have called me to do this, because I stumble over my words. I'm like, blah, 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 half the time. And sometimes from up here, who knows? But that's the thing. God will speak through you when God sends you to do something. Now, after this last thing, this is where I started laughing out loud last night studying. Because Moses said, God, just send somebody else. You know, I know you gave me all the material and the proof and the reasoning I need, all the tools that I need to do this for you. But just I can't. I've got these sheep or these goats, whatever they are. I got to go do this. My father-in-law's going to be mad. Who's going to take care of the fields? Who's going to do this? I can't speak right. And I can just imagine in this, God, it says, in starting in 14, it says, that then the anger of the Lord burned against Moses. And he said, and he's like, is there not your brother Aaron the Levite? I know that he speaks fluently. Now, there are a couple times in the Bible, in the scriptures, where God's speaking to people, and you can verbally feel the sarcasm to a degree. You can verbally feel God's like, I've had enough of this guy. He said, is there not your brother Aaron the Levite? I know he speaks well. He's good at talking. And moreover, behold, there he is. He's coming out to meet you. He'll be glad in his heart. So you are to speak to him and to put the words in his mouth. And I, even I, will be with you, will be with your mouth and his mouth. And I will teach you what you are to do. Moreover, he shall speak for you to the people, and he will be as a mouth for you, and you will be as God to him. You shall take in your hand this staff, which you shall perform the signs. And the reason I laughed at this is just because I'm sitting there thinking, Moses is coming up with all these excuses, like, I can't, I don't want to do it. This is, no, not for me. Send somebody else. And God's like, listen here, pal. Listen. You know what? There's your brother. Take him. He'll talk for you. I'll tell you what to do. You just tell him what to do, and he'll take care of it. Get your stick and go. I realize that's kind of paraphrasing a little bit, but that's pretty much what God said to Moses right now. And you know what he did? He got his stick and he went. Now, the way this fits in is, what was God wanting from Moses? Was he wanting Moses' obviously his not ability to speak? He wasn't wanting Moses' courage, because he wasn't very, courageous, apparently. What did God want from Moses? Because Moses, he didn't think they would believe God sent him. He didn't think they would believe that God spoke to him. And he was worried about his lack of ability to communicate. What God wanted from him, number one, was his obedience. God wanted him to be obedient to what he said, because God knew that this was going to put him out of his zone. God made him. God knew this was not, Moses' comfort. It wasn't his speaking in front of people probably was not his favorite thing to do. It's not mine. I'm just being real with you. But I love standing here with the opportunity to speak for God. God wanted Moses to be obedient. And God wanted his willingness. And as I was studying this, the word willingness kept sticking in my brain. I'm like, what is this one for Moses? I don't understand. And then it was like, okay, so imagine you're in your field with your flock, with your sheep, with your goats, tending to them. And over on a hill, You see a bush on fire that's not burning up. And you know this is your job. This is the fleshly job you have. And you're like, I got to check that out. I got to get me some of that. I got to see what that is. I got to figure out what's going on here. He was willing to leave everything behind that was his purpose, that he felt his purpose in his life on earth, to go see what this new thing was, because he knew something was different. He could see it was a bush that was on fire and talking. All right. So God wanted Moses' willingness. He wanted his willingness to leave his life to do what he's supposed to do. As Christians, was this water for me? Okay, just make sure it wasn't up there for a bird or anything, sorry. I don't know. Yeah, a little dry mouth. Thank you. But God wanted Moses' willingness to go. Not so willing to go, but his willingness to do something crazy. Because he did. And Moses eventually went. Now, I put this in a little cliff note here. What did God not want from Moses? Any more excuses. He didn't want any more of those stupid excuses that Moses was coming up with. Because God gave him every tool he needed. Just like God gives us every tool we need. Everything that we need in this life to do the will of God and to do God's work and to find God and to seek God is given to us. Sometimes we can't find him. Sometimes we can't hear him. Sometimes we can't see him in our lives or in the world or wherever we're at or whatever we're doing. But God has given us the tools and the intelligence and the spirituality to always find him. God did not leave us without breadcrumbs. Leave a trail of breadcrumbs to find back. I realized as I said it, I'm like, I hope everyone knows what that means. Yeah, God didn't leave us without a loaf of bread. So moving on to Isaiah. We're going into Isaiah 6, and I'm going to speed up the reading here. I tried to work around this and trim out some of the scriptures, but was not having that. So in Isaiah 6, it says, in the year of King Hazael's death, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, lofty and exalted, with the train of his robe filling the temple. Seraphim stood above him, each having six wings. With two he covered his face, and two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called out to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the thresholds trembled at the voice of him who called out, while the temple was filling with smoke. Then I said, and this is Isaiah speaking, woe is me, for I am ruined, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Now stop here for a second. Imagine you walk into the temple and it's like, oh, there's God. There's the Lord. There he is. These big old angels with six wings flying around. That's one reason I love, this is kind of a little side note here. I love when you see angels depicted as these pretty little floaty, fat little baby angels and stuff. It's like, no, there's a reason in the Bible when an angel appears, it's like, fear not. Don't be scared. We get it. I'm a giant flaming wheel of fire. But he said, he saw and he's like, I'm ruined. I am not clean. In the days, the ones who went to the temples were the clean, were the pure. Or you would die. So imagine God sitting in this, you know, sitting here, says he's lofty. It's been a good time. You know, I did a little studying on that, the king. And everything was good. You know, people were praising. It was awesome. God was feeling good. God was like, all right, these people, my people love me again. And then Isaiah goes in impure and thinks he'll be killed. Then one of the seraphim, I just imagine this giant six-winged angel, Seraphim flew to me with a burning coal in his hand, which he had taken from the altar with tongs. He touched my mouth with it and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips, and your iniquity is taken away, and your sin is forgiven." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And then I said, "Here I am, send me." He said, "Go and tell this people." So after what Isaiah just witnessed, he was like, "Send me. I will go. I will go. Whatever you need done." He didn't even know what God wanted him to do. He just said, "I'll go." And the rest of this verse gets kind of extreme. And it says, and God said, "Go and tell this people, keep on listening, but do not perceive. Keep on looking, but do not understand. Render the hearts of this people insensitive, their ears dull, their eyes dim. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and return and be healed." And 11 says, "Then I said," Isaiah speaking, "then I said, Lord, how long?" Now, when I first started studying this, I was really thinking, he was like some of us, "All right, Lord, how long do I have to do with this? How long do I have to deal with this?" And that's where my mind was going with this part of the sermon. And I was, he's like, because there are so many times like, "God, how long do I got to do this job? How long do I have to be here? How long do I need to do this? Do I need to do this? But I started researching, because something about that thought did not feel right with me. And I started researching different, biblical scholars, different, biblical history and things. And this wasn't a, "Lord, how long?" Isaiah knew what God was saying here. And if I could put it in our words, he was saying, "Lord, how long will they suffer? How long will they be in pain? How long will they be in turmoil? How long do they have to endure this?" And God answered, "Until cities are devastated and without inhabitant, houses are without people, and the land is utterly desolate. The Lord has removed men far away, and the forsaken places are many in the midst of the land. Yet there will be a tenth portion in it, and it will again be subject to burning, like a timbereth or an oak, whose stump remains when it is felled. The holy seed is its stump. So what this means, and what was showed to me that this means, it's not a, "How long do I do this?" It's like, "God, I know you're sending me to tell these people of their own destruction. I know you're sending me to tell me that they will be wiped clean. That everything will be destroyed to start new in this land. How long will they endure this?" And imagine God saying, and this is paraphrasing that whole section into one sentence. And God said, "Until it's done. Until it's finished." Now, we went from Isaiah thinking, "I'm going to die because I went into a temple and I've seen the Lord unclean," to, "Lord, send me to whatever you want me to do," to, "All right, you want me to do that? You want me to tell them of their own destruction? You want me to tell them of their own, they're being destroyed, everything." But Isaiah did this. Isaiah did it. And when I asked myself, "Well, what is it God wanted from Isaiah here? What is it that, he wanted Isaiah?" Now, I'm not saying what he wanted him to do. It's like, what did he want from Isaiah in this moment? And God said all this. And the only thing Isaiah asked, he had one question. I mean, we were probably full of so many questions. Like, why? What? Really? A whole lot of stuff. We can't not ask questions. But Isaiah's only concern was, how long will they suffer? God wanted Isaiah's sympathy. He wanted Isaiah's sympathy for the people. He was only worried about how long people would be in this season and in this situation. And sometimes God will send people to certain situations because he knows that they have the sympathy to connect. If we had to go tell an entire nation of people of their own destruction, there's a way to go about it. There's a way to do it. There's a way to handle it. You can't just walk in, y'all gonna die, and just walk off. That won't work. That's not how God works. You can't do that. But showing Isaiah had sympathy, he had empathy for these people, he was like, how long do they have to go through this? And God's answer was probably not what he wanted to hear. But he went anyway. And the other thing that God wanted from Isaiah in this moment was Isaiah's honesty. Now, honesty is a big deal. Even if it's something people don't want to hear. Upon entering the temple, he immediately confessed. He's like, I'm living wrong. I'm sorry. He didn't hum-haul around. He was honest. So God wanted his honesty, knowing that he would go into these places, and he would go into this place and tell people, it's like, listen, this is what's going to happen. God has sent me to tell you these things. God has sent me to tell you this. He wouldn't run from it. He wouldn't tell them something different. He wouldn't tell them something, God's going to destroy you, but there was no but. He knew that Isaiah would tell the truth and do it with love and sympathy and understanding that I know this is not what you thought. I know this isn't fun. I know this isn't good, but this is what's going to happen. This is the message God gave me. And the last, I got my papers all here mixed up. In Samuel, 1 Samuel 1 through 10. Nah, I like Samuel. Samuel's, yeah. And starting in Samuel 3, 1 through 10. It says, now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord before Eli, and the word from the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were infrequent. God wasn't speaking very much. It happened at that time as Eli was lying down in his place. Now his eyesight had begun to grow dim and he could not see well. Eli was dying. And the lamp of God had not yet gone out. But God was not done with him yet. And Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of the Lord was. And the Lord called Samuel and he said, here I am. And he ran to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call. Go lie down again. So he went and laid down. And the Lord called yet again, Samuel. So Samuel arose and went to Eli again. Here I am, for you called me. But he answered, I did not call, my son. Go lie down again. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor had the word of the Lord been yet revealed to him. So the Lord called Samuel again for the third time, and he arose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. Then Eli discerned that the Lord was calling the boy, and Eli said to Samuel, go lie down, and it shall be, if he calls you, that you shall say, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lie down in his place. Then the Lord came and stood and called, as at other times, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. The Lord said to Samuel, behold, I am about to do a thing. I'll cut it there, because there's a lot to that, but this is the part I want to focus on. One, because I like, you could really sum up every prophet in the book with God saying, I'm about to do a thing. It's like, gotcha, let's do this. But looking through here, Samuel was obviously young. He was not very, he was not nodging the word, the scriptures, the scrolls. But God was calling to him a total of four times. Samuel didn't know the voice of the Lord yet. He wasn't, he didn't know what it was. And Eli said, go take you a nap. And I love this part of this because in our lives we are so busy. We're so rushing around. God, what do you want me to do? God, what do you want me to do? Let me do this. Let me do this. God, what do you want me to do? Eli told Samuel, he said, go lay down. Just go lay down. And if you hear it again, answer. A little side note, sometimes God will speak to us mostly in our rest. Reason, dream, you know, he sends dreams. Because in our lives, we are, when we're rushing around trying to do everything, and work and school and kids and family and, you know, this messed up, oh, this messed up, well, I got to fix this, oh, I got to fix dinner, I got to do this. We don't give time to hear. So Eli said, go take a nap. Go lay down where you were, sleep a little bit. If you hear it again, answer. And you notice here, he didn't say, go pray about it. Go to the altar, think about it. He said, go sleep. Go lay down. Relax. Relax, man. Chill. And when he said, Samuel, Samuel, Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. Now, this day and time, if you tell people you're hearing voices, a little different situation in 2020. But, if you really dig into the Bible, it was like that then, too. They sent them out, some of them out in the woods and the desert eating locusts and stuff. But anyway, but this is the thing. God called to Samuel three times before Samuel was like had some direction. But if you noticed, God never said, Samuel, do this. Samuel, hey, get up, do this. Samuel, hey, get up, do this. He called his name. He called for him. Three times, until Samuel responded. Now, in these examples, it's all about us saying, okay. Okay. Samuel said, I'm here. What do you want from me? Well, I mean, that sounded a little bit rude, but I don't think it was quite like that. That was more of what Moses probably would have said, the way he would have said it. But you know, what is it, God, that you want me to do? Because at that point, he knew, the fourth time he knew something was different about this. Now, what did God want from Samuel? Samuel had heard God's voice, but he didn't know what it was because he had never heard God's voice before. God wanted two things from him. First, he wanted him to listen. He wanted him to listen to him. Because those of us who have kids, hey, I use my daughter example, if you're listening. Faith. Faith. Hey, Faith. What? Nothing. I call her, you call their names and they just stare at you. And I'm like, I'm going to sell you. I'm not, I promise. To the internet world. But the thing is, you know, that's the way God was with Samuel. He's like, Samuel, Samuel. And until he responded, there was no direction given. And God said, I'm going to do a thing. He wanted Samuel to listen. He wanted Samuel to listen to him. And he wanted Samuel to be still and wait. Because each time Samuel was called the first three times, he ran to Eli. What do you want? What do you want, Eli? What would you like? Eli's like, I didn't say anything. I didn't say a word. All right. I could probably see Samuel, if you know, being young, he's like, crazy old man. I know he's talking to me, playing jokes on me or something. But he wanted him to listen. He wanted him to wait. and be still. When God gives us charge sometimes, when God gives us our calling, when God tells us something he wants us to do, sometimes, most of the time, we can't hear him because we're not waiting on him. We're not listening to him. We're too busy, like we said at the beginning, we're trying to find out his will and not trying to find him. So, a short recap. With Jeremiah, God wanted his boldness and his courage. He was young. He said, people aren't going to listen to me. And God said, yeah, they will. Moses, he was afraid they wouldn't believe God spoke to him. He was afraid that people wouldn't believe him. And he was afraid that, well, I can't speak right. So I can't do this. Send somebody else. God said, yeah, you can. Isaiah, he was worried. He didn't want people to suffer. He was like, I'll do this, but I don't want to. And God said, you can do this. And with Samuel didn't know the voice of God, yet he was hearing him. And Samuel said, what can I do? And God's like, this, you can do this. And in our lives, how many times does God want us to do something and we're like, I can't do this. You know, I don't know what I'm doing. No one will believe me. No one cares. And as Christians in 2020, how often do we get that feeling that no one cares about God or what we're saying or the message or any of it? It really feels that way a lot of the time, that no one cares. But what does God want from us? Now, use these four examples, and these four are, obviously biblical examples of God choosing and using people, creating people for a specific purpose, a specific reason from the womb. Now, I never thought I would be a preacher when I was young. I'm thankful. I love my brother. I never thought he would pastor again, but I'm glad he is. I never thought that, honestly, I was 29, never thought I was really going to get married, have kids. They're not here, so some of you might believe me. But here's the thing. God has a reason for everything. God has created each of us for a specific reason. There's a calling. There's a purpose. There is something that God wants us to do. And we have to listen. We have to be bold, courageous. What does God want from us? Now, when we think about this, it's like, oh, well, I'm courageous. I'll tell anybody about God. Well, I'm sympathetic. I'll cry with this guy a little bit if something sad happens. It's like, oh. But what does God want from us? He wants one word. All. All. He doesn't want you in the good times. He just doesn't want you when you're happy. He wants your sadness. He wants your depression. He wants your anxiety. He wants your mourning. He wants your grief. He wants your happiness. He wants your joy. He wants your doubt. He wants your aggression, your anger. He wants all of these things. He wants you to give them to him. Because none of these, and there are so many more examples in the Bible. One of my favorite is David. God equipped David to kill Goliath long before the call was there. He was killing lions and bears and all sorts of stuff. I don't know if y'all seen lions and bears in person, but they're scary. They're big. And that's the thing, is God wants all. From these four examples in the Bible, the things that God wanted from them was their all. Obviously, Moses had doubts. Moses was scared. Isaiah was, this is tough. But God wanted those. God wanted those fears. God wanted all of this. God wants everything about us. We are not just creatures for God in the good times. We're not just creatures for God when things are going well. We are creatures for God all the time. And he wants everything that is us. He wants everything that constitutes us. Because if we don't give all, if we don't give everything, when we get saved, and I'm not saying everything goes away when you get saved, that's a whole other sermon, but when we get saved, you know, our anger issues might not go away. Mine didn't. No, Mike has seen those. You know, our depression may not go away. But when we give our heart to God, when we give ourselves to Christ, when we know that He wants all from us, we're the same person, but our soul is different. And our soul will make us realize things need to change. And with all this, and Him wanting all of us, if you give Him everything but your depression or your fears, or if you find your joy in something else, God can't use you the same way He could if you were all in. These guys gave their all. Even with all the excuses, all the fears, all the concerns, they gave all. I mean, there's books written about them throughout history. So, but what does God want from you? What is it that you've not given to God yet? What is it that you still are so concerned with that it distracts you from giving God your all? And hence the title of the sermon, what does God want from you? It doesn't matter if the person sitting next to you is, you know, has something going on. You need to give God what is yours, no matter what it is, because that's what He wants. You cannot serve God and try to hide things from Him at the same time. One, because He sees everything. But two, when and if things are found out, whatever it may be, everything can crumble around you, and it's just going to be worse. So we have to give God all of us, everything about us, every single thing, from the good to the bad, because He's the only one who can take care of things. He's the only one who can fix things. He's the only one who can give you comfort, who can give you rest, who can give you peace. Not entirely sure how you guys do altar call and stuff, I don't. That was kind of a... When God's done with me, it just stops. So it's one of those. Sometimes people look at me strange, but let's. I mean, do you want to come up? I don't know how you guys do this. So there you go. Sorry, it was a weird way to end things, but I don't.
Every time I tried to make it on my own, every time I tried to stand and start to fold, and all those lonely roads that I've been traveled on, there was Jesus.
When the life I built came crashing to the ground. When the friends I had were nowhere to be found. I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been, where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, I couldn't see it, there was Jesus. For this man who needs an amazing kind of grace, forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day that there was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the valleys, there was Jesus. In the shadow of the alleys, there was Jesus. In the fire, in the flood, there was Jesus. Always is and always was. Whoa.
Let's have our ushers come at this time. We'll have our offering for this morning. Pray with me if you would. Your kindly gracious Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for this day, God. We thank you for this service. We thank you for this time that we can come together as your people, Lord, and worship you, praise you, God, and learn a little bit about you and try to learn what it is that you want from us, God. And we just ask that you take up this, that as we take up this offering, that it would just be for you, that it would go for what you would have it go for, that it would continue to sustain your ministry here at Sunnybrook and whatever you would have us do with it, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
This morning you brought us together. We have worshiped you. This morning we have praised your holy name. Thank you for this time that we're able to do that, Father. We learned in Sunday school this morning that we should glorify you, and that should be what we should be about. And we've, I believe, done that this morning. We learned from our brother that we need to continuously be open to what you have for us to do for you. And we need to recognize God's voice and then go forth and do what we're called to do. Lord, this morning as we think about all the things that we need to talk to you about, we had prayer concerns that we've brought before you even this morning. Those will be listed on the email that goes out today. Lord, we ask for answers for these prayers, and Lord, we just ask you to be with us this week and help us as we try our best to glorify you. And we ask this prayer in the name of your precious Son, Jesus. Amen.
Then join us on Wednesday for our Zoom meeting, and back here next week on Sunday for service here or virtually, wherever you may be. Mikey, do you know of any announcements that we want to share this morning? Anything coming up? Okay. Well, visit us on Facebook. Visit our website. If we have any announcements that come up this week, you'll see those come out online, social media, wherever they may be. But thank you for joining us. I hope you had an awesome, awesome service this morning. Thank you for coming, Jeff. We appreciate the message. Awesome message. Loved it. Every bit of it. Sometimes I always wonder how everything's going to tie together. And when the songs come and then the message comes, and Mikey and I can attest to that, there's times where I have no clue what's going on. And then last week, the songs lined up exactly with what you were doing. So it's like, almost like somebody's controlling everything. I don't know what it is, but I mean, could be something like that. I don't know. But if you would come up and pray us out, and then we'll go and enjoy the rest of our day today.
Once again, I would like to thank Jeff for coming and delivering the message. And, you know, I'm never one to add to a message, but one thought that kept going through my mind there at the end when you know, he said, what does God want from us? Is there's two ways that we ask that question. One is, Lord, what do you want from me? Or, Lord, what do you want from me? And that hit hard. How do we ask that question? And what does God want from us? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you, Lord, we just thank you so much for just you being you and you just being the God that you are, so magnificent, so holy, so awesome, and worthy of all praise, honor, and glory that we could ever give you, Father. Lord, we thank you for the message that you've given us through our brother, Father, Lord, to listen to you, to be still and listen, and just to give you everything, Lord, our best, our worst, and everything in between, Father, Lord, to give it all to you. And, Lord, you just use it how you see fit, Father. Lord, we just glorify you and we praise you, Father. And be with us throughout this week, Father. Lord, be with this nation throughout the week and its unrest. Be with this world throughout this week and the pandemic, Father, Lord. Lord, we know that you're in control of all things. Not a second, not a millisecond goes by that you don't know of. And we give it all to you in your hands, Father, Lord, in faith. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for who you are and what you do. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you guys.